Welcome, sir.
How do you do?
Fleet carrier, the most impressive fighting machine the world has ever seen. This one ship can unleash a greater variety of lethal weapons with a greater destructive power at longer range than any man of war in history. By the time she reaches the end of her working life, this ship will be 50 years old. The battleships she replaced seldom lasted, at the most, half that time. And they were, for centuries, the backbone of every navy. For the past 40 years, the aircraft carrier has dominated naval warfare. This veteran will never become out of date. Her weapons and her technology are constantly renewed. The carrier will be around for another 40 years.
We are on board USS Forrestal, 80,000 tons of steel, home for nearly 5,000 men, a floating airfield for 70 or more combat aircraft.
Forrestal is a maritime air base. She can move at 40 miles an hour, 1,000 miles a day. Forrestal is home for very powerful aircraft, several squadrons of them. She can fly the whole lot off in half an hour. Combat aircraft are a match for any others in the sky, detecting and destroying submarines, destroying other ships, or hitting targets many hundreds of miles inland. She can deliver every sort of missile and bomb, including nuclear bombs. Forrestal has the right aircraft for every one of those tasks. No wonder the carrier became the capital ship, the backbone of the Navy. I served in seven of our carriers. I commanded the Ark Royal. I was second in command of the Eagle. In my first carrier, I was a very young midshipman. Both American and British navies were quick to see the importance of the aeroplane at sea. Even before World War I, they were flying aircraft off ships. It wasn't quite like this, though. If at first you don't succeed, they even laid a few planks across the big guns of a battle cruiser. Hasty improvisation that worked. Another type, of aircraft carrying ship, a converted cross-channel ferry. In those primitive days, sailors thought the aeroplane was simply for scouting. It would be what the frigates had been for Nelson, what the cruisers were at Jutland, the eyes of the fleet. In World War I, the Royal Navy built a huge air force, 100 airships, 3,000 aeroplanes. Most of these aircraft were based on shore. They couldn't fly very fast or very far. Somehow, naval aviation had to take its aerodromes out into the ocean, because to get airborne, an aeroplane needed a runway. So they built one on HMS Campania, an old Cunard liner. As early as 1917, the Royal Navy was getting closer to the true aircraft carrier. There was a runway of sorts. An aircraft could fly off. But still aircraft couldn't land on deck. Then at last, they got it. HMS Argus. Converted from an Italian passenger liner, she was the world's first flat top. Her navigation bridge sank flush with the deck. It caused some difficulties in steering the ship, but it did provide a clear flight deck. Argus had a hangar for the aircraft and workshops to service them, a lift to bring them up to the flight deck. Argus was the original aircraft carrier. A little clumsy looking maybe, but truly the prototype of more than 200 that followed. And they're still being built. By happy chance, at the end of the First World War, the Royal Navy had three unwanted battlecruisers. They were large and fast, as fleet carriers have to be. They were given a long flight deck. They could steam fast into the wind, which made it easier for the pilots to reach flying speed. But landing was difficult and dangerous, and it still is, on a tiny moving runway. Before very long, wires were stretched across the deck, and the arrestor hook was invented. It worked. It still works today. Between the wars, the Royal Navy invented or perfected almost all the techniques of shipborne flying. Britain was ahead of the world in everything, except the aircraft. In those days, the Royal Air Force had the monopoly of all military flying. Naval aviation was split between the two services. A naval flyer had to be an officer in both the Navy and the Air Force. One result of this dual control was that the Navy didn't get the aircraft its aviators deserved. But even if they had, the Admiralty didn't really understand the proper uses of maritime air power. They still thought aircraft were for scouting, and with luck, to delay the enemy until the battle fleet could catch up. Airmen were spotters for the big guns. To the admirals, the aircraft was a useful long-range telescope, not yet a long-range gun. The Royal Navy only had control of aircraft embarked in ships. Just as important were shore-based maritime aircraft, but these stayed with the Royal Air Force, and the air marshals didn't give that top priority. To put it bluntly, if the admirals were not air-minded, the air marshals weren't sea-minded. They wanted to fight their own war in the air. Just before World War II, the Royal Navy regained full control of its air arm at sea. But British naval aviation was hobbled by history. They still didn't have the best aircraft. Many still believed the carriers existed merely to help the battle fleet. But when the war came, the British carriers did very well. Of course, the Royal Navy couldn't choose where to fight. They often had to operate their carriers at a disadvantage, in the narrow waters of the Mediterranean, against a much larger shore-based air force. There was one outstanding British carrier aircraft, the Fairy Swordfish. Known affectionately as the string bag, the Swordfish was slow but sturdy. It could fly from a carrier in almost any weather. It could carry prodigious loads, and it was robust. In 1940, the Navy sent just a few to attack the Italian fleet at Taranto.
Now take a look at part of Mussolini's fleet at sea. Sensation. Actually, I need hardly point out, this picture was taken before Italy entered the war. You'll notice the ships are moving. Three out of six of his battleships almost blown out of harbor by our bombs.
The first ever airborne torpedo attack from carriers had sunk three battleships. The aircraft carrier had come into its own. There were others who had already come to the same conclusion. December the 7th, 1941. Japanese launched a strike force of 350 aircraft from nearly 300 miles off Hawaii. The carrier had become the most important ship in the Imperial Japanese Navy. The other ships were used to protect them, even the hitherto all-powerful battleships. Attacking Pearl Harbor, there wasn't just one carrier, there were six. Japanese knocked out all but one of these eight American battleships. By good luck, the American carriers were not at Pearl Harbor that day. The destruction at Pearl was immense. Japan was about to seize an empire in the Pacific. The American Navy had to be put out of action. That's why they attacked Pearl Harbor. But the Japanese didn't finish the job. They reckoned without American sea power, based on their carriers. The carrier was the American capital ship, too. And the fast carrier striking force was the fleet, the true descendant of the old battle fleet. In the vast Pacific Ocean, the Americans had less need of shore bases. Their ships stayed at sea for months on end, supplied by the fleet train. Both the Americans and Japanese had long prepared for this war. American admirals were also air-minded. They had lost nothing to a separate air force. They had full control of their naval aviation, on shore as well as at sea. Some of America's admirals had themselves been aviators. They had a feel for this kind of war, and they knew what kinds of machine their pilots wanted. They had the right aircraft embarked in the right ships. They were such good aircraft that the Royal Navy acquired a great number for themselves. The war in the Pacific was a hard, murderous business. It took nearly 4 years to drive the Japanese back to their home islands. Nearly 4 years of bitter and bloody fighting. At one time, the Americans were reduced to only 3 big carriers in the Pacific. One of those was British. These were the aircraft that in the end swept the Japanese from the skies and sank 5 battleships, 11 carriers, 150 other Japanese warships. Navy pilots were well trained. They had to be. Everything about flying from a carrier was dangerous, especially when returning from a mission. In the Pacific was mainly an American war. But by the end of it, there were 5 big fleet carriers of the Royal Navy with the American fleet. In one respect, they were far superior. They had armor-plated decks and sides, but American carriers had wooden planking on the flight deck and no armor. That cost them dear when the Japanese launched their kamikaze suicide attacks. these were the principal ships of the Pacific Fleet. They were huge and tempting targets. Everything depended on them, victory or defeat. Final stage of the war, 2,500 fanatical Japanese pilots volunteered to fly a one-way mission to certain death to destroy them. Kamikaze pilots never reached their target, but one in ten did get through. Nearly 200 ships were hit. The carrier Franklin, after attack from the air, nearly 1,000 dead and wounded. Still afloat, but useless as a fighting ship. By the end of the war, America deployed 100 carriers, mostly in the Pacific. There are only 20 in the whole world today. Naval warfare had become carrier warfare. The Second World War taught the Royal Navy that sea power also means air power. Every naval commander must have his own planes. Without some sort of carrier, an admiral would have only his helicopters and shore-based Air Force planes if they can reach him in time. But the ocean is so vast, there is no substitute for high-performance aircraft based at sea as part of the fleet.
The trouble is, these large carriers cost a fortune. That's why we didn't replace the Ark Royal and the Eagle.
In my own lifetime, I've seen the Royal Navy bring the fleet carrier to perfection with inventions like the steam catapult, the mirror landing sight, and the angled flight deck. But to build a new fleet carrier today would cost £1,000 million, and Britain can't afford them any longer. But we can still afford the high-performance aircraft that our admirals must have at sea. The Sea Harrier, a British invention. It doesn't need a long flight deck or a steam catapult. It doesn't need a reservoir. Its carrier doesn't have to turn into wind for launching. Put the Sea Harrier on board a new kind of carrier, the Invincible class. Invincible has yet another British invention, the ski jump. This gives the Sea Harrier an extra heavy punch. The Russians have also built a sort of Harrier carrier. This is one of them, the Minsk. The Americans are very likely to follow suit. But vertical takeoff carriers are still no substitute for the big carrier with big aircraft, which can carry more, faster, and farther. It's been argued that the big carrier has no place in a future war. People say it's a sitting duck. But the big carrier has all the weapons to defend herself against missiles, against torpedoes. Her own aircraft can seek out and destroy the air bases or the ships or the submarines where the torpedoes or missiles come from. And the carrier has other ships, as anti-submarine and air defense escorts. But even the Americans find new carriers expensive, so they won't scrap Forrestal and her sister ships. Instead, they'll strip out the insides and replace all the electronics and weapons, and the aircraft, of course, 10 million pounds a copy, still expensive, but a quarter the cost of a new ship. And big carriers like this will last another 25 years into the 21st century.
These huge aircraft carriers have been the supreme embodiment of sea power for 40 years, the latter-day ships of the line, launching platforms for nuclear weapons and guided missiles, a complete anti-submarine and air defense system, a mobile air force. They must, one day, vanish as the battleship did, but by then, they're likely to have had a much longer run for their money.